Okay, thank you and good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, and we have no apologies for today's meeting. Phil McGregor and Karen Adam are joining us virtually today and Richard Leonard is also joining the session today and we welcome Richard to the meeting. Our first agenda item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, the Draft Maximum Number of Judges Scotland Order 2022. And I welcome to the meeting Keith Brown, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans, and his Scottish Government officials, Ryan McRobert, Head of Courts and Tribunals, and Joanne Tinto, Solicitor Legal Directorate, who are joining us virtually. Remember, I refer members to Paper 1. I wonder if I can ask the Minister to speak to the Maximum Number of Judges Scotland Order 2022.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'll be very brief. The maximum number of judges is set out in Section 1.1 of the Court of Session Act of 1988. This order in Council will increase the maximum number of judges of the Court of Session by one, from 35 to 36. Judges of the Court of Session also sit as judges of the High Court of Justiciary. An increase in the number of judges of the Court of Session has been precipitated by the recent appointment of Lady Poole as chair of the COVID-19 inquiry. Lady Poole is an outer house judge of the Court of Session on secondment to the inquiry, and during the secondment, Lady Poole will not be available to sit in court. However, she remains a judge for the purposes of the statutory limit in Section 1.1 of the 1988 Act. As that inquiry is expected to last for several years, the Lord President requested an additional judge to meet the demands of the business in the Court of Session and the High Court. The appointment of Lady Poole to chair the COVID-19 inquiry, coupled with the current high level of court business, means that the appointment of a further judge will provide additional judicial resource during these challenging times. The Lord President does not consider that it's possible to appoint a further series of temporary judges drawn from the Shrieval Bench for this period of time, as this would place additional pressure on the Sheriff Courts and would therefore not secure the most efficient disposal of court business. Happy to answer any questions from members, Convener.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. So, members, Pam, I think you've got a couple of questions.
I do, thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and your officials. Thank you for setting that out. Have you taken account of the numbers of the backlog during the COVID-19 period in terms of the number of judges that might be required? Do you think that this is enough? And also, have you considered the Lord President's suggestion that there is primary legislation to look at the availability of judges, the number of judges on the basis of the availability of full-time equivalent judges that are available to us?
I think the answer to the second point is no. I'm not sure that we have looked at that from the Lord President, but the order before us today is at the request of the Lord President, and it's partly for those reasons that you mentioned the backlog. We're very keen to make sure that we do tackle the backlog, and that's perhaps why we've gone beyond the previous limit of 35, which in itself was increased from 34 in 2016. We don't want to see the business to deal with the backlog slowing down. That's why I want to appoint a further judge. And we've also looked at other things which may help in relation to sheriffs sometimes are elevated in that way, but that would provide more pressure on the sheriff courts. So we are trying to balance that. But yes, this increases capacity for the court at a time when it would otherwise reduce because of the appointment of Lady Poole to the Child Abuse Inquiry. And I'm pretty sure the Lord President said to me in his letter that it was to do with the backlog as well. So that has been taken into account.
Thank you.
Okay, any further questions for the Cabinet Secretary? Okay, no further questions, so we therefore move straight to item 2, which is the formal business in relation to the instrument. So it's consideration of the motion for approval for the affirmative instrument. So invite the Minister to move the motion.
Moved.
Okay, do any members have any final comments? Okay, if not, so are we therefore all agreed? Okay. That is agreed, and so I invite the committee to delegate to me the publication of a short factual report on our deliberations on the affirmative SSI that we've considered today. Is that also agreed? Brilliant. That concludes consideration of the affirmative instrument, and obviously the Cabinet Secretary is staying with us for the next item. The Minister's officials online are free to leave. So the next item on the agenda is to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary as part of our Stage 1 scrutiny on the Minor Strike Pardons Scotland Bill. a welcome to the meeting. Excuse me, Scottish Government officials, accompanying the Cabinet Secretary, Elaine Hamilton, Head of Forensic Policy, Policy Powers Unit, Police Division, and Louise Miller, Solicitor in the Legal Directorate. And I refer members to papers 2 and 3. Can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement, please?
Thanks again, Convener. This landmark bill honours the commitment which the Scottish Government made to bring forward legislation to pardon minors of certain offences relating to the miners' strike of 1984-85. It follows up a recommendation made by an independent review panel that a pardon should be granted to minors who were convicted of certain offences during the strike, subject to qualifying criteria. The pardon was intended to recognise the disproportionate impact felt by those minors as a result of taking part in the strike, to restore dignity to them, to help the mining communities heal old wounds. To establish what the qualifying criteria should be, the Scottish Government undertook a public consultation last year, and the provisions in this bill reflect both the outcome of that consultation as well as careful consideration of the available data. It's important to emphasise at this point that there is very little surviving evidence from police and court records from the time of the strike. That's why I do not propose to put in place an application scheme for the pardon. I wish to make the qualifying criteria as simple as possible so that people are able to assess for themselves whether the qualifying criteria for the pardon are met without having to find documentary evidence. Therefore, the bill proposes a collective pardon to minors which will apply automatically to those who meet the qualifying criteria. These are that the minor's conviction relates to an offence committed while on a picket line, demonstration or similar gathering in support of the strike, or travelling to or from such a gathering. The qualifying offences are breach of the peace, breach of bail conditions, and under section 41(1)(a) of the Police Scotland Act 1967, commonly known as obstruction. This bill, Convener, is about reconciliation and dealing with the past in a sensitive way. The conditions of the pardon recognise minors and police officers found themselves in extremely challenging situations where relationships came under unprecedented strain. Minors who took part in industrial action did so to protect their jobs, their way of life and their communities. Police officers were only exercising their duty to uphold the law and in circumstances and on a scale which they had never encountered before. The pardon will apply both to living people and posthumously, given the passage of time since the strike. The pardon does not quash a conviction, neither does it create any rights or entitlements. I am clear that the bill should not cast any doubt on decisions made by the judiciary at the time or seek to place blame on any individual or group of individuals. So thank you. And once again, Convener, I'm happy to take the committee's questions.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm kind of keen just to probe a little bit further in terms of the decisioning and the reasoning around having an automatic pardon system rather than a process. And I guess the thing that's from the evidence that we've heard from people in mining communities, the thing that they would appreciate would be some sort of official confirmation of the pardon, particularly when it's a posthumous pardon. So you have perhaps a widow. And I think there was a feeling that having something that person was able to show that their loved one had been pardoned would be particularly welcome. And it's whether it's possible to do that without some sort of a process to have an automatic pardon, but yet still have some way of having a piece of paper which the person can know that their loved one was pardoned, even though that they're now gone. Because I think that's one of the challenges we heard, that many of the people who are impacted have passed away.
It's a very good point, Convener. We are examining what we can do around that. The reason for the automaticity of the pardon is to make it as easy as possible for people that can't necessarily provide the evidence or documentation. In fact, we can't provide much of the evidence or documentation to sustain that. But I think the idea that people really have to know they've been pardoned is an important point. So we are looking at whether we can, first of all, work with the NUM to look at their records to see if we can reach out to as many people as possible. There may be data protection issues in relation to that, but we'll observe those, of course. And beyond that, whether we can make a written statement, it will have to rely in some cases on people getting in touch with us because we won't have the information. And it will be the case, it will not be able to go into the details of anybody's particular conviction,
mainly because those records are no longer held. But the written letter, if we're able to do that, convener, would make explicit the details of and the qualifying criteria for the pardon. It would make it clear to that individual and to their family that they were part of that pardon. So that's what we're looking at just now.
So request, do you think, is that the right claim?
I think that's, we're still looking at this, convener, but I think that's likely to be the case. Apart from, as I say, if we're able through the NUM's records, and we're just starting to get into discussions with them to identify quite a number of people and any certainty around the convictions that they had. If we can do something proactively, again, we'll look at that as well. But there's bound to be people that will not be captured by that, and we want to make it as clear as possible. If they want to get in touch with us, we will give them as explicit a statement as possible in writing about the pardon.
OK, thank you. Maggie.
Thanks very much, Joe. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for those remarks. I hear what you say about the scope of the pardon and it being limited to actions around the picket lines and travel to and from. We've heard from miners who were directly involved in the strike, and we've heard from miners and some of the wider community members associated with, you know, supporting striking miners. One of the concerns with that limit of actions around and travel to and from picket lines is it doesn't actually cover many, it doesn't cover everybody. And in one of the evidence sessions, we heard somebody say, you know, the pardon is welcome, but it won't mean anything unless it does cover everybody. To give you an example, it wasn't around a picket line, but as you know, people who, miners who broke the strike were living in the same communities as striking miners, and there were often tensions around that. And sometimes the attribution of blame of violence or not violence to people, but damage to property was problematic. And I think that there's some questions around why those cannot be covered as well, those kinds of incidences that are clearly directly related to the strike, but aren't at or around a picket line. Can you say a little bit more about why we can't extend it, or would you look at the option of extending it to actions associated with the miners' strike, which would include those kinds of activities in the community?
Well, first of all, just to say, of course, we'll listen to any representations that are made. We've had substantial consultation with interested parties, mining communities, trade unions and others. And there have been, as you say, calls for offences to be included. Some of those will fall under the 1875 Act, which I'm sure we're all very familiar with. But that could cover quite a wide spectrum of behaviour relating to attempting, without legal authority, to compel another person to support the strike or not go to work. Your point about miners that continued to work during that time. It would necessarily cover the use of violence to intimidate another person or their family or damaging their property. It could also cover behaviour such as persistently following another person from place to place or following along with others in a disorderly manner another person in or through any street or road. It can cover things like watching or what they call besetting a house. And I think the problem that we have is a lack of any surviving police and court records that make it very difficult to confirm the exact circumstances in those instances that you've mentioned, which are committed during the strike. We couldn't cover, for example, the degree of violence or malice that was involved or whether where they actually occurred. So it's also very difficult to determine the motivation behind such conduct. We do know there were some cases or reported to be cases where previous disputes between people were the basis for some of the things which happened during the strike. So we have extended what the independent review group said. So, for example, we're not putting a constraint on it to say that you're disqualified if you've had a previous or a subsequent offence, but we don't think it'd be right to extend it to these other potential offences when we can't really ascertain the details of it. So we've tried to make it most applicable to, or exclusively applicable to, minors and to those incidents which are said in those locations can be going through communities if that's where people are travelling. But that's why we've had those qualifying criteria. Apart from extending it slightly, that's why we followed the views of the independent review group.
Okay, I hear that. I suppose I'm just looking to see if there is a way through. I appreciate what you say, and I appreciate that the act that you mentioned would maybe cast the net wider than we might think appropriate. But I think I'd be interested in exploring if there is a way through, especially not necessarily the activities or that you described. You know, we can't assess malice or that kind of thing. Well, you know, I mean, in many ways, we can't make those kinds of judgments about what happened at the picket lines or travel to and from them either. And I think there is something about understanding that the strike happened in the context of community, not just at the picket lines, and recognising that, I think, somehow will be important. I'm not quite sure exactly how, but I think we do need to look at that somehow.
Can I say that it does come down to those kind of judgments? You're absolutely right, but I think it's also true to say that if we were to try to seek to pardon those kind of convictions, it would set quite a precedent for similar offences committed in current times or in the future. And I think as well that based on the consultations that we've had, there'd be a lot less sympathy for things like street fights, intimidatory conduct, violence and damage to property. I think just the point about the picket line is important because the view that we are taking, and you're right, these are judgments that you have to make, is that the balance of probability is that the miner's conduct was directly on a picket line or on a demonstration or going through a community to attend one of those things was much more likely the conduct was directly related to support for saving jobs rather than an action born of anger or retribution against an individual. So you're right, it's a question of judgment. That's a judgment we're making, but of course we'll listen to other points of view.
Thank you. Alexander.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. There's no doubt that the stigma behind this whole situation, and I, as I've said in previous meetings, I don't remember an industrial dispute being so bitter and so divisive in my lifetime. As a youngster, I watched, as many did, it unfold in the media and the television, and communities were really badly affected. The whole idea of the pardon is being processed, but it's the community work and what's happening within communities now that is just as important to trying to rebuild some of that process. And it would be good to get a flavour, Cabinet Secretary, of what you think should be supported within communities for that reconciliation, because there is a desire to try and have that truth and reconciliation. The pardon itself goes some way to addressing that, but it doesn't address what happens within the communities that were affected. And it would be good to get a flavour of what you think of that, because as I've asked and I've said in the last couple of sessions, some people think that the pardon itself is perceived as rewriting a bit of history, in that it was over 3 decades ago, but the communities today are still in a situation of turmoil 3 decades later.
Yes, some very good points, and I would say your first point about how divisive it was. I mean, there were other divisive disputes, and I remember the Whopping dispute, if you remember that one, how divisive that one was. But what was different about this was, as you say, the communities. Whole communities were identified as mining communities. The area that we both represent, for example, having a number of communities and others across Scotland, and it's those communities, the geographical nature of the mine and the community surrounding it, which meant that that division has carried on for all those years. I think the pardon, just to say, is really important. If you've talked, and I know the committee has, to former miners, a number of these people were people who had never been in trouble with the law and felt a degree of shame for having had a conviction. Some didn't, because they felt what they did was justified. I acknowledge that. But some felt shame, it was wrong. And I think the impact of a pardon on those that are still with us, that will know about that, I think is quite substantial, knowing that it's been pardoned. So I think it will have a big effect. But you're right to say we have a continuing obligation to those communities. So to that extent, I attended on Friday, as it happened, in Hawk Hill Community Centre, an event which was for that centre. But they had the Coalfields Regeneration represented there, and I spoke to them at some length. They still do things like football for youngsters in the communities in Tullibury and so on. But we continue to look to support the work of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust in the former mining communities. The annual grant is £754,000 this year, and that's helped fund grassroots activity which tackles issues associated with poverty in these areas. And you're right to say there's a long tail of consequences from that dispute and people having lost their jobs that we're still dealing with. I think we may be, I don't think the rest of the UK, I'm not sure about Wales, have continued with the support for the Coalfield Shared Generation Trust, but we have done that, and we'll continue to work with the Trust so that the grant addresses the new challenges. And if we can concentrate our efforts on regenerating those communities that need it most and working with local people to deliver the change that we want to see, that's perhaps the best and most effective thing we can do to try and help those communities. But I also think that the pardon will have a real tangible effect for many people involved as well.
Because the pardon, as you say, is very tangible. That maybe heals some of the individuals and the families and the way they believe. But the community at the end of the day, as you identify, is what is most important. That we try to rebuild and reorganise, and the support mechanisms that are in place to make that happen are vitally important. And the legacy from this bill itself should also try to incorporate some of that to ensure that we're not just looking at something that happened, as I say, 34-odd years ago. It's something that happens today, and the communities today have to still manage that crisis. So is there any scope for you to think about how that might progress within the bill, or is there other ways of doing that in future?
I would say I don't think the bill would be the vehicle for doing that. I think the legacy of the bill will be the impact that the pardon itself has on communities, and just to reiterate that we'll have a very significant... It's basically the... It's not the state that was in control at the time, but it is the Scottish Government, as now established, as saying we understand the pressures that obtained at that time that led people into these situations, and we want as a society to pardon that. So that is what the bill... We made it a very simple, straightforward bill for those reasons. I think that you're right, though, the other work has to continue going on. And just to say that work started right away. I know I used to work for Stirling District Council, and work had gone on right from the strike by that council in its various different political guises to support communities in Fulham and Pleen and so on. And that was true across Scotland. So this is not new, although because of the time that's elapsed, it finds the help for regeneration finds itself through different routes. And the main route the Scottish Government takes through that is to support the Coalfield Regeneration Trust, and we intend to commit to that.
Thank you. And online now, please, to Fulton McGregor.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and officials. Just picking up from Alexander Stewart's line of questioning there, I'm really glad to hear the Cabinet Secretary's commitment there. I've got some mining communities in my own constituency, and you know, I witnessed firsthand both the impact of the Coalfields Regeneration Trust and the work that that's done and the support by the Scottish Government, but also the ongoing need to regenerate these communities that are still very much struggling from, you know, their mining past. I've got two questions, Cabinet Secretary. The first one is, I guess, following on from Maggie Chapman's line of questioning. It's about the definition of a miner. And just to see, you know, obviously we'll go into a stage one debate and producer report, but I think it's fair to say that the committee are inclined to think that the scope of the definition of a miner could be increased. And I think the Maggie's question was more around other things that happened in the community. But even on the strikes themselves, we heard some examples of miners having maybe family relatives or others. I think there was we heard from one person who was a son of a miner and was on a strike. He never got charged, but there may be examples of that. Is that something that you would consider widening the scope of the bill to?
Yeah, I think the answer I gave to Maggie Chapman would still stand. We did think long and hard, as did the Independent Review Group, about who was most directly affected, and we feel it was the miners themselves. I mean, many other people, myself included, got involved in demonstrations at the time, but we don't think so. There are people, students included, and others who did receive convictions, but we think it is important that we restrict this to the miners involved and for the qualifying offences. For the reasons I previously mentioned, but it might be worth, since you've raised the issue of the definition of a miner, which really relates to employment of mine, I think, owned by the National Coal Board. But I don't know if they... I think I'm going to answer that instead of the official, which is that there's a... So there are a number of matters which had been considered. It's not a straightforward thing informing the government's position on how a miner should be defined. We consider, as I say, they're the people most adversely affected by the strike, and the consequences of strike-related convictions were for the miners themselves. So Only males were allowed to work underground in the UK coal mining industry in 1984-5, and so inevitably the focus on the numbers arrested, prosecuted and conviction was on male miners. The definition has, however, been drafted to recognise that there may be other persons employed by the Coal Board or a licensed person under the Coal Industry Nationalisation Act 1946 that may meet the pardon criteria, and that definition recognises that some surface employees also experienced their livelihoods being directly threatened by mine closures and may have participated in or taken action in support of the strike. In fact, we know that they did. I know people myself who did, that were surface employees. But the policy intention is to capture the persons who worked underground in a coal mine, at the surface of the coal mine, and at larger workshops located out with coal mines, which are used to maintain and repair mining equipment and machinery. So I think you can draw a line about people whose livelihoods were directly related and under threat because of the strike itself. The definition would also cover female employees who met the pardon criteria. However, we're not aware of any robust evidence to suggest that any female was convicted in Scotland for offences which related to the strike. So that's why we've come to that conclusion. We think the miners are most directly affected, and not least because of the poor quality of the evidence still available, records and so on. To extend it further would be problematic, and we think that we've struck the right balance in relation to that. But as I've said before, we will listen to representations.
Yeah, thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. And I think that one of the things that we did here is it might be difficult to establish exact numbers of other people involved. You know, when we spoke to the retired police officers, they couldn't recall anybody that would be outside the current definition criteria. And then when we spoke to miners themselves, they did suggest that there would possibly be some, but they might again be a limited number. So I do understand that there is that there is difficulties with establishing a number, but at the same time, it might be quite a small number, and it might be very important and significant for these people if that could be included. But I hear and take on board the points you've made. My second question for the Cabinet Secretary Convener is around the compensation aspect. We've heard quite a wee bit about that as well, and I wanted to ask the Cabinet Secretary what his thoughts are on compensation for individual miners that have maybe, lost out through the, they've maybe been dismissed or whatever because of the arrest. What's the Cabinet Secretary's thoughts on that?
First of all, I think the pardon, both since those that have called for it, including one of our former members, Neil Finlay and others, was this was about reconciliation. I'm not trying to say Neil Finlay's views on compensation might not be different from mine, but I think the rationale for this coming forward is about the reconciliation, which I spoke about in response to my answer to Alexander Stewart. And I believe a compensation scheme, first of all, it wouldn't be consistent with the proposal for miners to self-assess the eligibility for pardon. You would have to have a much more stringent process if people were applying for compensation, and given the lack of records and so on, that would be problematic for quite a number of individuals involved. It also runs a risk of the bill moving away from its intended symbolic effect and into the territory of questioning decisions by the judiciary at the time. And just to make clear, we're not doing that. We're not quashing any convictions. We don't have the ability to look back in time, assemble the evidence and do that in any event. And also, a compensation scheme runs a risk of creating a precedent for pardons that are granted in the future. So other legislation for pardoning convictions, such as the Historical Sexual Offences, Pardons and Disregards Act of 2018, did not offer compensation, and therefore there's a risk of legal challenge. And the other point I would make is that employment and industrial relations are reserved to the UK. So to the extent that if the compensation is looking to compensate for loss of earnings, loss of pension, loss of other rights, the Scottish Government wasn't an employer, wasn't party to the dispute, wasn't in existence at the time. And the issues it touches on are employment issues, which are for the UK Government to consider. We have and will continue to press the UK Government to hold a full public inquiry. And that is the place where those kind of issues should be discussed or addressed. But for us, we think the pardon is a reasonable measure to try and introduce some a reconciliation in communities that were driven apart during the strike.
Thanks for that, Cabinet Secretary. And you'll be aware that at the outset of this bill, initially I was, and still am, of course, sympathetic to the issue of compensation for miners But I've came to the conclusion through the evidence and hearing what you've said there that, that actually, if people remain sympathetic to compensation, that it is not the place of this bill to do that. And actually, it could potentially even hold up the bill and the pardon that the miners need. And I will join you as an MSP for a mining community, and I hope that the whole committee will, in pushing the UK government to do more. And you're absolutely right that, given where employment law lies, it's absolutely right that any compensation issue should be taken there. But I'm very satisfied with what you said today, and I wouldn't want this bill, which is so needed in the communities around Scotland, to be delayed. But I do remain sympathetic to these miners who have missed out on so much, receiving the right compensation. Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. And that's me, convener.
Thank you. And moving to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener. And I've listened carefully to the Cabinet Secretary's answer to the previous question, but I'd just like to ask a bit more about that, and in particular the public inquiry. I understand it's the government's view that a public inquiry would have to be UK-wide, given that trade union laws and employment law is reserved, as you've described. But having read the public consultation and also heard the evidence from miners and also from police and others who were involved in the strike, the information that we got from miners and the information that we got from police didn't really add up. And I feel like that probably needs a little bit more exploration to look at the nature of how the strike was policed. And of course, that is a devolved matter. And even prior to devolution, regional policing was in operation, and decisions on strikes in this area were taken in Scotland and regional forces. So what is your view on holding a public inquiry in the aspects of the strike that were and are devolved responsibilities?
Yeah, I think it would be consistent with my previous answer, which was the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament didn't exist at that time. And your point about the fact that well, policing wasn't devolved at that time either, but one of the allegations was, for example, like a cabinet subcommittee, there was a reference to the way that the policing of the strike should happen in Scotland. I don't know the exact terms of it, but it's around the fact that the Secretary of State for Scotland was asked at cabinet to ensure it was policed in the same way that the rest of the UK was, which goes to one of the accusations made at the time that there was political direction in terms of the policing of the strike. There's also allegations in relation to whether security services were involved, whether phone tapping was involved as well. We are in no position to examine those things. It's not within the competence of the Scottish Parliament to do that. And I think in trying to do it without that evidence, we would undermine the calls which I know I have made, and I know others have made, my predecessors have made, for the UK government to hold an inquiry. And when I wrote to the UK government in relation to this recently, I said that the very process of us having this bill and highlighting this will increase pressure for that proper public inquiry to happen. Now, I know that can seem like a forlorn hope sometimes with the UK government, but they have recently at last agreed to have an inquiry into the treatment of people convicted of homosexual offences in the armed forces before, I think, 2000. So it is possible to achieve this, and I think that's where our focus should be, because those are the people, those are the agency that have that evidence. And to the point that you say, well, policing is now devolved, I've already mentioned the extent to which there's policing records for sometimes very good reasons, because that is a process, what's called the 40-20 rule and the 70-30 rule. 40-20, I think, is when you achieve the age of 40 and it's been 20 years since the conviction, then the police destroyed the records. And if it was something which was more serious, when you achieved the age of 70 and it's been 30 years since the conviction, you destroyed the records. So we don't have the records to look at that in the way that would be suggested, the rigour that a public inquiry should bring. But on the outstanding questions about the policing of the strike and how it's managed, and the political aspects of the strike, I believe the right focus for that is the UK government, and I'll continue to put my focus in that direction.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm not sure that I think that the two could or should be mutually exclusive. I think that there is still some questions that need to be asked, particularly in Scotland, and I think it could be helpful for us to do both. I was interested at your opening statement when you said that the bill doesn't seek to apportion blame, which I find slightly at odds with pardoning something to not necessarily apportion blame. I also think it links to the point about compensation. So I'd be keen to know what are your views on the way that the strike was policed at the time?
Obviously, I have my own experience in watching watching it contemporaneously, and I was never on the picket line. I'm pretty sure though, as a student in 1984, I was involved in demonstrations and certainly some supporting activities. You'll remember there's a lot of activity among students and community groups to help in a welfare basis with the minors and so on as well. And like everyone else at that time, I saw the pictures coming in from Orgreave, for example, where the policing to me seemed inconsistent with the policing methods that were happening in Scotland. I think that distinction sometimes is still there. If you look at COP26 recently, if you look at the policing of the aftermath of the Sarah Everard, the conviction that followed that, policing in Scotland followed a different path even then. However, the allegations that were around at the time, for example, that officers didn't have numbers on their tunics and so on, and there was a lot of grievance because it was a very tense, heightened time. I remember that, Bilston Glen, all the different mines where there were issues. But I think what we're trying to do is to say that was a time of heightened tension. It was very difficult for the police as well. They hadn't been put into that situation before. So I don't have enough evidence to make a judgment on what the policing was or where it fell down. What we do, though, is that miners were trying to defend their communities, their way of life, their livelihoods, and that led to some of the situations which happened on picket lines. And for that reason, we're trying to see if we can bring some reconciliation to those communities and some, if you like, some comfort to those miners themselves who are convicted, that have had that conviction hanging around them for quite some time. So that's what the purpose of the bill. I'm not trying to pretend it's trying to do anything else, and there are good reasons why I don't think we should try to do the job that should be done by the UK government, because we don't have the facility to do that, we don't have the records, and we don't have the competence in terms of the Parliament to look at some of those issues.
Thank you. Returning, I think, to one of the previous questions where you were asked about the travelling to a picket or to participate in it. I'm interested in swallow my own saliva, it's a horrible thing. I'm interested in the point you make about women and convictions of women at the time. And I wonder if in looking at a broader scope for the bill and supporting some of the people who had convictions for things that weren't about going to a picket line, but were perhaps for collecting for the strike fund or participating in another way, may actually broaden it and could be another way where women who were involved at the time may also be able to be pardoned. I also think it would be interesting to broaden it from the perspective of there will be a lot of people who right now will look back and think I would like to have stood in solidarity with them. And I'm one of them. I was very young at the time. I heard about the strikes and I knew about them and they were a topic of conversation. But I feel like if we broaden it, we're able to say to people that it's okay to stand in solidarity with people and that you won't have to experience what they experienced as well. And so I think it's quite important, actually, that we look at broadening this out. And I know that Unite and ASLEF have both made that suggestion. So what is your view on how we could try and involve some of the activity that took place that wasn't about travelling to picket lines or on the picket line?
I think it's probably just as I've said previously, although there's not, an exclusion of women because we don't have any evidence of any female being convicted, certainly not for the qualifying criteria. I don't think we've got much evidence beyond that. I think the figure of 5% out of all the convictions that we're aware of relates to those that wouldn't come into the qualifying criteria, but I'll maybe ask Elaine to come in relation to that. I do think there's a danger, though, looked at this quite closely, and it must be the same, I would imagine, the same rationale that the independent review group, on which we had people like John Scott and Dennis Canavan, I think the rationale for that is the more you make it spread out more widely, where you're able to get less and less evidence to support that, the less value the pardon itself has, I think. So I think that's my thinking, but I don't know if you want to come in on the figures, Elaine, if you've got them. I'm sure I saw one which said 95% of the convictions, or 5%, were for those offences not covered by the ones which we are seeing are qualifying offences. But maybe not. We can provide the committee with that evidence in due course. But yeah, that's the thinking behind it.
Yes, that is correct. We have information from Hansard, where data was provided in response to parliamentary questions. And there is a snapshot of data taken in the first 3 months of the strike, where a question was asked, well, how many people who were not minors have been arrested? And as the Cabinet Secretary said, at that point, for those 3 months, 5% were not minors. They were students, unemployed people, bus drivers, teachers, a mixture of occupations. But that was in terms of arrests. We don't know if those arrests then led to convictions. And as I say, we only have that 3 month snapshot. We don't know if that trend continued for the rest of the strike. So it is actually very difficult to know, to have any kind of evidence base as to how many non-minors were actually convicted as a result of participating in the strike.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. We could go to Karen Adam now, please.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for the whole meeting so far. I found it really interesting. I found it quite interesting over the last few weeks as we've been scrutinising this, and it's certainly, you know, as others have said, thrown up those memories of back in the day watching these images on TV. And I'm sure, I was moved, and I'm sure the committee were moved by some of the testimonies that we've heard. There was one in particular from a Robert Young who told the committee he was arrested multiple times and personally dismissed by the Coal Board following the strike. He said, people have to remember the psychological side of the miners' strike. You have to understand the effect it was having on people. And miner Alex Bennett, who was heavily involved in the strike leading to his arrest and a fine from the courts and eventually dismissal from his job. The psychological scars of the strike are still felt to this day, and some of that relates to the atmosphere of the time. And it's important, that we remember that impact on those. Not just those, but people around them, people directly affected and indirectly affected, and the whole community. So the pardon, in part, is an official validation for the struggles that the miners face. And, you know, I agree with my colleague Fulton, who was saying, you know, if we start looking into other aspects of this, such as compensation, it might delay this pardon somewhat. So I'd like to ask Cabinet Secretary, what more could be done? And I know this may be slightly out with your remit, but while you've been looking at this bill, what could be done out with or alongside this pardon to ensure that full recognition of the struggles are recognised and never forgotten? And should we be calling on anyone else to take some responsibility too?
Yes, I think more can be done, and I'm more than happy to listen to any suggestions the committee and its members have in relation to that, and they've made some already. I think there will be attendant publicity as this bill progresses, the committee's deliberations, and when it goes to the chamber, and hopefully when it's passed as well, and that will bring some additional awareness across the country, and also hope that it would actually give some heart to those in Wales and England who are in a similar position to see what's being done here as well. I've mentioned already about the idea we might be able to try and see if we can write out to as many people as we can legitimately identify and go beyond that where it's possible to do that. But I'm more than happy to commit to give further thought to what else we can do to, as you say, try and address the psychological the really scarring effects of this strike and the scarring effects on individuals from having a conviction, especially when, for many of them, this will be the only conviction they ever had. They'd never looked to get in trouble with the police at any other stage of their lives. So if we can maximise the impact of doing this, then I'm certainly open to suggestions as to how we do that. And I think you're right about the compensation. You have to remember what that means for individuals if they have to go through a compensation route, those that are still alive. Rather than get an automatic pardon. So I do think it's important that we focus on that. And on your last point, yes, I think that's the point I've tried to make, that we will continue to put pressure on the UK government, not to blame the current members that are there for things that happened in the 1980s, but they have a responsibility as that government to address some of the issues which are concerned. We've said that consistently and will continue to say that to the UK government.
Thank you.
Thank you. We can go to Pam Gossel, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and officials. We've been told that because the miners' strike was so long ago that there's lack of evidence. Therefore, the automatic pardon was the way forward, best course of action. Given that evidence is so scarce, and would you agree that somewhat being precautious to suggest that the easiest way is to list the offences that should not fall under the pardon than actually do those that do. Of course, the fact that more violent crimes were not written off by the fine is reassuring. But wouldn't you agree that basically just listing the offences However, would you agree that by only listing the offences not included in the pardon, it would leave the pardon open-ended and open to interpretation?
I certainly think that it's problematic because it might surprise some people to find that the list of offences which are not listed are much greater than the ones which are. So we'd have to do a much longer list to say which ones are not subject to the pardon. And that approach will only work if Parliament are minded to favour a blanket pardon with very limited exceptions. As things stand, as I say, there are three qualifying offences, but the 5% that cover a number of other offences, and those include vandalism, assault, possession of an offensive weapon, careless driving, etc. They set out, we could set out the offences not to be included, but I think it's easier, not least given the fact that we've defined who is a minor and that it's minors that we're seeking to address here to specifically say which offences are being pardoned. I just think that's a more clear-cut approach both for the public to understand and for the minors themselves that are concerned by this, if that's the question that you're asking.
Yeah, Cabinet Secretary, yeah. I mean, obviously we've heard from minors and it is heartbreaking listening to what happened at that time, but also we've heard from police officers at that time. And today is about minors, yes, what we're talking about, but we're also looking at what the law was. And not everybody actually, obeyed by the law for different circumstances. And I couldn't possibly sit here and go back and say what was right and wrong, but we're basically looking at the law as well, that the law was there to help as well. So it wasn't always there to hinder. And looking back, we need to make sure that we're respecting those police officers as well that did get injured at that time, that, you know, of no fault of their own. So I think that's what I'm trying to say, that there's no loophole in this, that, you know, I agree that this legislation should go forward, but also making sure that those that were injured, that we are making sure that we're looking out for them as well.
Well, I think in relation to injuries and other aspects, the Retired Police Officers Association and the Police Pension Fund, I think, will look, has got a responsibility, as are others like the Police Federation, to look after its members, and that they'll do that very effectively. I think the point is to the minors, they lost often all of that. They had no pension fund. If they were dismissed from the job, I'm not sure about their pension, but certainly they lost their employment rights. But I think you are right to say that there are some things like a serious assault on somebody we're not looking to pardon. We've made that clear. And the distinction between this pardon and, say, the historical sexual offences one is that what we were saying there, I think that what the Parliament was saying there, is that was a category of offences which were wrong. The whole category of offences breached people's human rights. We're not saying that in relation to this. We're not saying that the body of law which was brought to bear, or the justice system itself, well, we're not saying that that was wrong. We're not in a position to say it was wrong. We don't have the evidence or the ability to go back in time. But there wasn't the fundamental systematic undermining of people's human rights as there was with the human rights. And given that's the case, we're not looking to quash any convictions. We're not doing that in relation to this. We're providing a pardon because of the exceptional circumstances. So you're right, there are some offences which would have had implications, sometimes serious implications for individual police officers. You'll have heard that evidence from the Retired Police Officers Association, and that is another reason for the approach that we're taking, I think.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, thank you. And Richard?
Convener, first of all, thank you very much for allowing me to take part in this morning's evidence session. I really appreciate it. Cabinet Secretary, I've got a couple of questions, some of which reflect on what you've already told us. But, I mean, for example, did I hear you say earlier on that those convicted of an offence under the Conspiracy and Protection of Property Act 1875 will now be included in the pardon?
There are some categories. I maybe get the officials to come back in that. So
We are saying that there have been calls for those kind of offences to be included within the scope, although I think, again, it's worth pointing out that the Independent Review Group did not make that specific recommendation. So a conviction under that Act could cover a wide spectrum of behaviour relating to attempting, without legal authority, to compel another person to support the strike or not go to work. So, for example, the use of violence to intimidate another person or a family is not going to be covered. It could also cover behaviour such as persistently following someone else. I know we discussed this previously, from place to place. We're not looking to cover that. It also could cover watching or, as I've said, besetting a house. And just to add to the fact that the lack of surviving police and court records make it difficult to confirm the exact circumstances that give rise to any offence in the 1875 Act committed during the strike, such as the degree of violence or the malice attached. So that's why we're taking the position we are. I don't know if you want to come in and say anything in addition to that, Elaine.
No.
That's why we're not. It's not covered. Sorry.
Okay, so it's not covered. I mean, I think most people accept that if there are public assaults involved, they are not included in the pardon. But I think this Act, and I think only a handful of people in Scotland were convicted under this Act, is about encouraging people to take part in strike action, which seems to me to be directly related to the activities around the strike, which, in my view, ought to be covered. But we shall debate that as the bill goes through Parliament. One of the other things you mentioned earlier on, and again, keep me right on this, because I was obviously wrong on the first one, was that I think you said that in relation to answers to questions about community-based convictions, which are currently excluded. You did say something about going through communities, which reminds me of a case of one of your constituents, Jim Tierney, who was convicted, arrested and then convicted in Alloa Sheriff Court for allegedly throwing a missile at a working miner's bus outside Fish Cross Miners' Welfare. He was convicted, but disputes and has got evidence to support his disputation of that. But are you saying that you are willing to accept that in a case like that, this could be covered by the pardon?
No, I mean, I don't know enough for the details about the case. I know the Fish Cross Miners' Welfare, which is no longer called that, very well. I think I related to the story about things being thrown at my car. There were snowballs. That was a different context, and I'm familiar with Alloa Sheriff Court. We can't go into that. I think, as I've explained already, we can't go back. Although, if what you're saying about Mr. Tierney is correct, there are levels and avenues of redress which can be taken forward by him in relation to that. And that's the best way to do that, through the judicial system. But no, what we're saying is somebody travelling through a community on the way to a demonstration or to the picket line or to the work, that is included. So just to make sure, because I seem to have caused some confusion in my previous answer, it may be me that was wrong rather than yourself. We'll maybe get to Elaine to just be specific on that. But can just add for your own information that you said, and you were right, there were very few convictions, 16 convictions we know of in Scotland under the Conspiracy and Protection of Property Act. Prosecutions, according to the records that we know about, solely to have taken place within Strathclyde region. At the time of the strike, the maximum penalty was £50 or 3 months in prison, and we don't know what the disposals were. But I don't know if you want to add to anything that clarifies that. Specifically in relation to travelling through, where we're covering that and where we're not covering that.
Yes, yes, thank you. Just to be clear, that the pardon covers conduct at a picket line, but also for marches, demonstrations and rallies. Now, those could have taken place in the community, and therefore any convictions for a demonstration which took place in the community would be covered. And the other point is that travel to or from such an event like a rally, if it happened in a community. I mean, I think a lot of us have heard the story of the busload of miners which was stopped on the A8, for example, and everyone was made to go off the bus and they were all arrested. So that kind of scenario would be covered if they were on their way to a demonstration somewhere else. There are certain convictions which took place within a community which are covered by this bill. I don't think it's fair to say that it's only the picket lines, because it's not. I am aware of Mr. Tierney's story, and you know, obviously, you know, there is a strong sense of injustice there for Mr. Tierney and the other gentlemen who were arrested alongside him at that particular incident. But as was said, it is very difficult. I think once you move away from collective situations like demonstrations, rallies, picket lines, it then becomes quite difficult to be sure of motivations for certain conduct. Was it one individual against another? And this pardon is a collective pardon, and it's aimed at areas where miners were acting collectively in support of the strike. And I know there will be points raised about blanket pardons and where do you draw the line or if there should be any line. But as the Cabinet Secretary has said, there's very good reasons for why the criteria in the bill are as they are. The lack of records makes it very difficult for any assessment to be made of the circumstances which gave rise to any of these convictions, whether on a picket line or elsewhere. And therefore, the feeling is that it's important that we pardon the miners collectively for what happened during this dispute.
Related to that is another point, and again, Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned the eastern villages, Fallin and Pleen, for example, which were a flashpoint in the strike back in 84-85. And evidence given to the Scott Inquiry was that if you take, for example, the village of Fallin, which is where the Paul Mays colliery was, the miners at Paul Mays were 100% out. So there was no question of there being a need to take action to discourage people from going into the pit. But yet there was it's reported in the Scott Inquiry that there was a very heavy police presence nonetheless in the community, which led to tensions in the community and which led to arrests and subsequent convictions in the community. Don't you think then there is a case to extend the scope to understand that this was a dispute which wasn't just conducted at the gates of the colliery or even on demonstrations, but it was a dispute which was conducted in communities as well?
I think there's no question that it was something that impacted on communities. And one reason, of course, I should mention the fact that we launched or publicised this pardon at Fallin at the outside, outdoors Miners Museum, which I'm familiar with, have been for many years. But just as you've said, even if they're 100% out and there's heavy policing presence and arrests emerge from that, they will be pardoned by this. They will have been at that demonstration. They will have been wherever it takes place in the community. If there's a demonstration or if there's something on the picket line, then those things should be captured by the qualifying criteria that we have. And I'm not aware of, and generally I'm not aware of, any instance of somebody in Fallin that might have been convicted for reasons which are out with the qualifying criteria of the pardon. I've given the reasons why we think we should restrict it in that way. I think it also makes it a more meaningful pardon for those to whom it will apply. But I'm not aware of, and it may be because you'll know yourself, there's quite a lot of secondary picketing went on as well. So people from one community would go to another to support them as well. But what we're saying is, I think it's legitimate and it's for the best of reasons. It's restricted to minors and it's restricted to those qualifying offences. And that will include, in Fallin, being at the picket line or being a demonstration in the community.
And I accept that you're not aware of any convictions in Fallin in that context, but you are aware of the conviction of Jim Tierney, for example, who's one of your own constituents in your own constituency. The final area I just wanted to probe a little bit more, and we've heard members of the committee say that they are not in favour of a compensation scheme. Well, I am in favour of a compensation scheme, and the reasons to me are pretty straightforward, because we know, again, if I quote the Scott Inquiry, that there was an element of arbitrary application of the criminal law by the police, prosecutors and the sheriffs. So there was an inherent injustice there that they have found. And they also spoke about dismissals being disproportionate, excessive and unreasonable. In a previous evidence session to this committee, the former Lothians police officer Tom Wood said that, in his opinion, the dismissals represented extrajudicial punishment, and he thought this is a former serving police officer who policed the strike. He thought that the actions of the coal board were spiteful and excessive. And you mentioned Orgreave. But when we look at the figures, in Scotland, you were twice as likely to be arrested as you were in any other part or in any other coal field in any other part of the UK. And you were three times as likely to be dismissed as anywhere else in the UK. And people have spoken about the then National Coal Board Area Director, Albert Wheeler, conducting almost a vendetta. Anybody who was convicted was automatically dismissed. In other areas of the National Coal Board, that wasn't the case. There was a mood of reconciliation at the time in 1985, and people returned to their jobs. So don't you see that there is a Scottish dimension here, and the Scottish dimension here is one that needs to be addressed. And there has been psychological scarring, emotional scarring. Family lives have changed forever as a result of what happened, including what happened to those people who were convicted and then dismissed. And we've spoken about women not being included in those convicted. Well, that might be true, but many women who were married to minors, who were daughters of minors, who had relationships with minors, were condemned by those decisions and suffered huge hardship as a result of that. So do you not at least accept that there is a principle there, that there ought to be some compensation? You may say it could be paid at a UK level rather than as part of this bill. Members have spoken about a delay. It seems to me if you set out the principles in the bill, it would be possible to address that. It's been done in other instances where there have been injustices and the Scottish Government has decided to address those. So where do you stand on the principle of compensation? And surely you understand the arguments about the impact that this dispute has had and the injustices that were perpetrated on the miners, their communities, but also on their families.
Yeah, I do understand that. As I say, I was very much a follower of what happened during the strike in some detail, and was well aware of the communities, both where I lived and where I worked, of the impact of not just the miners, but the families and the entire communities. So I'm well aware of that. But my point is that, you know, the way that dismissals were carried, there were quite a few reinstatements afterwards in Scotland as well, probably higher because they had higher numbers proportionally of dismissals in the first place. But these were dismissals by an employer, the National Coal Board, which applied across the UK. They relate to employment law, which is reserved to the UK. So if there's a case for the compensation, and I'm not quibbling with anything that's been said about the loss that was endured by people, sometimes very hard to quantify because it was so huge. That is for the organisation, which was the state at the time. They were the authority at the time. They have the reserve powers to look at employment legislation. They have the powers to look into wider issues about the policing, about the extent of political involvement in the policing. We don't have those powers. And I think for us to try and introduce some kind of compensation scheme, apart from delaying, as has been mentioned by one or two members already, the potential pardon itself, we don't have either legislative competence to deal with that, in terms of getting all the facts around employment and so on, or the ability to get all the information that's necessary. That's why I'm not sure why somebody would want to oppose the idea that the UK government should be held to account for this. They have the ability to look at it, and they have the ability to get the records. Such records still exist, and to question things like if there's any substance to the intelligence services being involved. They can do that. We can't do that. So that is why I take the position, if there is to be one, it would be for the UK government to consider, and to give my commitment that I'll continue on behalf of the Scottish Government to call upon the UK government to hold that full public inquiry, which could cover those issues which you've mentioned.
Fulton McGregor now, please.
Thanks, Convener. It was really just to make a point of clarification on my friend and colleague Richard Leonard's last point. Then I want to put on record my thanks to Richard for all that he has done for mining communities. I know he is a big supporter of communities. However, he said there that other members, one of whom was myself, who talked about this, were not in favour of compensation. So I just want to make my point clear for any miners or mining communities watching. I am very much in favour of compensation. What I am saying is, having heard the evidence from miners and others, and also the Cabinet Secretary, that I am now convinced that this bill is not the place where a compensation scheme would be based, and it wouldn't actually suit the purpose of this bill. And in fact, what we heard from miners in our private session was that they are very much aware of the purpose and scope of this bill, and are content with that. So I wanted to put that on the record that it wouldn't be fair to say that I am not for a compensation scheme. I just don't think it should be in this bill. Thank you, Convener.
For that, Fulton. I don't think there's a question there, Cabinet Secretary. So we can go to Maggie Chapman.
Thanks, Joe. Just a follow-up, if I may, Cabinet Secretary. In response to my earlier question, you talked about some of the reasons for not extending the scope to certain aspects of community tensions. And I've just been thinking and listening to your answers to my colleagues, and I'm wondering, we know and we accept that this bill is about a pardon. It's not about quashing convictions. So what is the harm? You talked about it would set precedents elsewhere. We're not talking about quashing convictions here. We're talking about a recognition of the wider, as you said, the recognition of circumstances which were different to normal functioning of society. So I suppose I ask again, can you say a little bit more about that setting of precedents and why it is, given it's not about quashing convictions, what really is the consequence of what would be the consequence around that? I'm not sure I quite understand that link, given it's a pardon, not a quash.
I think it's really around the idea of being as relevant to what we're discussing as it's possible to be. So that's why we look at the miners who are most directly affected by it. And that's why we look at the offences where that point about the exceptional circumstances on a picket line, when your community is under threat and your job's under threat and the industry itself is under threat. So we're trying to recognise the particular circumstances of that. If you go to other potential offences and convictions, we've got much less ability to say what the motive was there, to say what was the circumstance behind that. And we don't have the records to do that. And if we did that, you could be pardoning things which include serious assaults on people or intimidation on people. Very few, I would say, but it's possible to do that. And that's why we think it's the right way to say it's the miners were most directly affected, and they were most directly affected on the picket lines in defence of their jobs and their communities. And we understand that what happened then was extremely unusual, extraordinary. I think Alexander Stewart's made the point this was probably the most divisive strike any of us can remember in terms of its longer term consequences. So we're trying to recognise that. And to go wider than that makes it, I think, very problematic for the reasons I've said. So it is a judgment, as I said before, and that's a judgment that we're making in relation to this.
Okay.
Cabinet Secretary, one of the officials perhaps should just maybe answer what the scope is for someone in a position like Jim Tierney, who feels that they're not caught by this pardon, but nonetheless feel an injustice was done as part of the strike, and you know what scope for them to seek redress.
I think that'll be for Louise. You're the legal expert, Louise.
There is obviously the criminal appeal route, which is available now and would have been available at the time as well. I think we probably need to be slightly realistic about the fact that with the number of years that have gone by, pursuing an appeal now would be difficult, because if it's on the merits, if it's on the facts of what took place, then the details relating to that, the evidence has now most likely been lost. I've seen some of the material relating to Mr. Tierney. I saw part of the interview with him on Twitter. I think at the moment, in terms of his relationship to the pardon scheme, he has two problems. One of them certainly is that it doesn't seem that this offence happened either at a picket or demonstration or something similar or while he was travelling to or from. I'm also not completely clear from the information that I've seen what offence it was that he was convicted of. If it was breach of the peace, which it could have been for throwing a stone, then that's on the list. But I don't know whether, in fact, it may have been something else. There are other possibilities that I think throwing a stone at a bus could have been charged at. So I think we've probably got a bit of a lack of information there
at the moment. I think there are still individual appeal routes available. They may well not turn out to be that profitable to follow at this point in time rather than decades ago. If that's not a realistic prospect, then it is a question of whether the scope of the pardon is wide enough, and that is really a judgment call. And the reasons why it's been created the way it has been created, I think the Cabinet Secretary has fully set out.
Okay, thank you. Any other members? Any final questions? Okay, thank you very much. I think that ends our session. Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary, and to both officials for giving evidence today. We now move into private session.